we get to Osmocom and LTE, which is sort of a bit of a sad story, but why don't we have anything LTE related at this point? Well, most of what we do in the cellular network infrastructure side is done by people who get paid for what they do. And that means the focus of the work is mostly determined by where customers are putting the focus. And there's basically a lot of customers that still are interested in 2G related stuff and not so many interested in LTE related topics. So that's why, at least at Sysmocom, we haven't been seeing lots of LTE requirements, so we don't have anything native related to LTE in Osmocom. We do have some LTE related bits that were introduced over time. One of it is we have support for, thanks to Max, we have support for SI2 quarter support broadcasting, which is basically the system information message in which EUTRAN, that's Evolved Universal Terrestrial Radio Access Network, so LTE, basically neighbor cells over GSM. The encoding is, how can I say, quite interesting. Definitely among the most complex things you need to encode in a 2G network, I would say. That we can do, and we have this SGS interface that yesterday Philip already spoke about, so I won't be covering that, but these are sort of the only two parts that we have. So, but irrespective of whether it's Osmocom or not, what do we actually have to do if we want to run a combined 2G and 4G? And of course the same applies more or less to a 3G and 4G network, but 3G is not so interesting to many people, so basically, there's three different things that we need to do if we want to run a combined 2G and 4G network. And that's basically, the first part is we need a shared subscriber database, which is, well, relevant for multiple topics, but the most pressing need is in order to get authentication from there. We have also the advertisement of the respective neighbor cells of the opposite or the complementary technology, and we have to have a shared packet switch tunnel endpoint so that when we move from one technology to the other, we can keep our PDN or PDP context and we keep our IP address and packets continue to flow. Optionally, there's some steps like the SGS interface that Philip has covered yesterday. There's also optionally, of course, the what's called inter-rad PS handover. So that's packet switched handover without any loss of connectivity. And also there's something called SRVCC, which seems to be the, not a grand unified theory, but it's sort of the ultimate the highest stage of consciousness or complexity for cellular networks. If you ever looked at that, that's really mind-boggling. So the shared subscriber database, as I said, we mainly require it for authentication. And if we want to have a really poor man's approach, actually it's not necessary to have a shared database because you can just put the same key information in the HSS and in the HLR. And of course, the sequence numbers will not be synchronized, so you will do a resync on every authentication, but the phones will still be able to attach. It's of course not sufficient. So the proper solution is to have a single HLR or HSS, which both has GSUB, which we need for the Osmocom 2G and 3G stack, and diameter, which is needed for LTE. Or in absence of that, a diameter to GSAP translator, which basically would make the LTE side use Osmo HLR, or a GSAP to diameter translator, which would make the Osmocom stack use an external HSS. So these are the three solutions for that. And I think I'll talk a bit more about what I think is realistic or what I would want to work on there. Now that's sort of the shared subscriber database part. The next part is the advertisement of neighbor cells, where the GSM side must advertise the LTE neighbors and the LTE side must advertise the GSM neighbors. So for SI2 quarter, it's in the code for years. in Osmo BTS. And if you look at the output of, let's say, a Thames phone, which is a phone that has a monitoring software proprietary, which gives you decoded RRC and other messages, it actually looks nice. But still, in practice, somehow, it doesn't always work for everyone. And we need to figure out what exactly is the problem there. So we have reports from users where they say, oh yes, my phone shows all the LTE neighbors, but somehow it never selects an LTE cell. So there's still something about the cell reselection parameters or some bits somewhere that maybe, even though it sees the neighbors, it's not switching over. And I don't think that is something that relates to the LTE side, because right now the phone is camping on 2G and somehow it's not, it's sticky and it doesn't want to move over. So we need to do some more testing there. On the LTE side, it must advertise the GSM neighbors, and that's unfortunately very vendor proprietary, because there's nothing like OML for the S1 interface, so every LTE eNode B has some other vendor proprietary mechanism by which you can configure the contents of the system information blocks, which includes the neighbor cell broadcast. So typically you have some kind of MIB or some XML interface or what, where you can insert the GSM ARFkins on which or which the LTE cell should advertise as neighbors. So both of these generally work, so we don't really need to do much there. And the third part is this shared packet switch tunnel endpoint, which basically means that you have the same APN and the same IP range and the same pool and so on, whether you establish a PDP context over GPRS or whether you do a PDN context on the LTE side. And the proper solution, well, there's even two solution topics here on this slide, so it's very, anyway. We need a combined packet gateway, a PDNGW or a PGW, and GGSN functionality. And if you look at what's out there in terms of free software, there's the ERGW, the Erlang gateway, which is an Erlang implementation that actually supposedly covers both GGSN and PGW functionality, untested in a sense that not, I'm sure somebody has tested it, but as in we do not in Osmocom have experience in testing that functionality. And it's rather complex and for sure nothing that you would, for example, run on a small embedded device. And Osmo GGSN, on the other hand, only has GGSN functionality and doesn't speak GTP version 2C, which is the control protocol that's used in LTE. We only have GTP version 1C. And NextEPC's packet gateway, on the other hand, has only GTP version 2C support and no GTP 1C support. So it doesn't do GGSN solution. So it doesn't do GGSN functionality. So we can either play with Erlang ERGW and see if we can make that work, or we can, for example, adopt the NextEPC code generation, because what they actually do in NextEPC is, I'll talk a bit more about this later, they generate the GTP2 C encoder and decoder routines from parsing the spec. Even though it's not written in ASN1. And by modifying the code generator, we could at least generate all the message encoding and decoding in an Osmocom style way and use that in Osmo GGSN. So that might be one way to add GGPv2C to Osmo GGSN to add this functionality. Well, SGS interface, as we know, we already implemented. Mostly needs interop testing with other entities, and we already found some unnamed large brand vendors who were unable to read the spec, which very clearly states how the host names are to be encoded, and they just send a string. There's some interop testing and workaround for bugs in other stacks, but otherwise that's done. And then the point is, yeah, inter-rad packet switched handover, and that's where it gets interesting. If you remember yesterday's circuit switched inter-MSC handover presentation, Packet switched is slightly easier because you don't have to forward voice calls over SIP in parallel to other things, but still it's rather convoluted and it adds lots of interfaces to the SGSN which we don't have at this point. So if you look at the diagram of a combined 2G and 4G network, then there's two additional interfaces called the S3 interface between the MME and the SGSN. And an S4 interface between the SGW and the SGSN. And you need those interfaces in order to do it. I don't know the exact details. There is some resources on the network, but basically since both of these are GTPv2C based and we don't have any GTPv2C at all yet, it's a rather long way if we want to support that. I mean, we don't do packet switched handover between 2G and 3G yet, neither circuit switched handover, but that is irrelevant in this context. So I think there's quite a bit of a road to go there, if we want to go there. Because this also ties into how cell changes are done in GPRS. So not sure if you do we yeah I don't have a yeah and I have time so I can talk about this. The traditional way, so if you start with classic circuit switch GSM, the way that cell change or cell reselection works, as long as you're in idle mode, as long as you don't have a dedicated channel, the phone autonomously selects the cell and camps on it. As soon as you have a dedicated channel open, it's the BSC that's in control of switching cells. So the phone reports all the measurements and the BSC computes what might be a good cell and then performs the handover there. In GPRS, the classic way, I mean, you don't have a dedicated channel, so you don't really have that distinction. In GPRS, basically, the fundamental basic level of functionality is the phone always chooses autonomously the new cell. And even if you have TBFs active, the phone will still be in charge of doing neighbor cell measurements and then switching to a new cell at its own completely without any interaction with the network. So it will basically pop up on a new cell and it will start to send LLC frames and then the SGSN needs to recognize that and move over. And if there's a routing area code change or a routing area identifier change, then it has to do a routing area update. In practice, that apparently doesn't perform so well if you are basically using a lot of time slots and have a very high TBF usage, because the phone then doesn't have a lot of time to do all the neighbor cell measurements and so on. And that's why apparently later in the specs they added network assisted cell change. It's called NACC, and with NACC basically the PCU, or let's say the network side, can request the GPRS attached phone to perform measurements and to report the measurements back to the network, similar to how it works on the BSC in dedicated channel. And then the network can basically either make suggestions or actually instruct the phone to switch to certain other channels as it roams around. And we don't have any of that, so we always have only the basic functionality to make the phone autonomously change. And the inter-rad handover requires, I think, or at least as far as how I understand, it requires some of those bits. So there's basically gaps in between what we have even on 2G and what's required to really do inter-rad handover properly. I don't think this will happen really soon unless somebody puts a lot of effort into it. So the logical steps to summarize to improve our LTE interworking is, well, the first step how we can play with this is to have the split HLR HSS and split GGSN PGW. That's actually, if you put up, what does this mean? It means you put your Osmocom network next to, let's say, an SRS E-Node B plus next EPC network, and you just put the IMSIs and keys in the HSS there and in the Osmo HLR on the other side. And you advertise the neighbor cells and you use the same MCC-MNC, and that's basically that level of integration. And you can do that. I played a bit with it. It's not great, but that's sort of the first step that you can do today. And then the second step for me would be to have this GSUB to diameter translator, preferably in the way actually a diameter to GSUB translator. Then beyond that, the shared GGSN as a follow-up step. So this translator, ties sort of into the next talk. I don't really like the HSF of Next EPC so much. So I think I would rather have a translator, and at the minimum you need exactly 4 diameter messages that you need to implement. So we need to implement exactly 4 messages that we translate to the respective counterpart on the GSUB side, and that's it. So it's a rather simple piece of software that I hope we can hack up in a limited amount of time, and then you can basically, you don't have an HSS on the LTE side, but you just use Osmo HLR for that. Okay, that brings me to the end of that talk, finishing ahead of schedule. Does anyone have questions, comments, feedback? Yeah.
So the GSUB was initially born as a replacement for MAP because MAP is super complex and obnoxious. Diameter seems to be much easier, so why don't we just speak diameter natively between HLR, GGSN, and so on?
Because there are no maintained diameter implementations outside of Erlang in free software, that I'm aware of, at least, let's say. There might be something in the Java universe I'm not aware of, but I'll talk about in the next presentation how Next EPC does it, and yeah, it's not so nice. So actually, for a very initial GSUB to diameter translator, I mean, the easiest way would be to use TTCN3. Of course, that's just for lab use, because we have both diameter. I mean, Ericsson has released the diameter code for TTCN3, and we have GSUB in there. So in terms of code effort, no, I mean, I'm just saying, you know, for a lab. But for a more realistic approach, I would actually do it in Erlang because of the Erlang diameter stack, which is also, yeah, it's not really nice to then have the dependency there. But yeah, I mean, just to make it work quickly, one can always do something else different in the future.
Maybe finally we can someday start speaking diameter. I mean, the idea of Max, I really like it. Like, instead of making our own protocol, we can just use diameter in 2G to like interact with.
Yeah, but I mean, so you have to change all the existing code for gaining exactly the functionality that we already have today. I mean, oh, I pushed some button. Is it still working, Kevin? Yeah, okay. There was a clicking sound while touching the microphone. So anyway, we are working on projects that have a scope that's incredibly large and the scope that's growing all the time with all the new developments that are happening. So I think we have to be very strategic as to where we spend resources and where not. And anything that already works sufficiently well without any fundamental problems, I would not spend effort on it. So if GSUB works, and it has worked between HLR, MSC, SGSN, keep it that way, and then you translate if you want to interoperate with other devices. Now, ripping it out and replacing it with diameter just because it's more elegant or whatever. Yes, it can be done, but I would rather suggest that people spend their effort on implementing something that doesn't exist yet rather than re-implementing something that already exists. But of course, everybody can spend their time like they want. I'm just saying there's so many things. And I mean, diameter is also not the end of the universe, right? You know, in 5G, there is no diameter anymore. So diameter actually has a lower shelf life than MAP ever had, right? So I'm not saying it's bad or anything. I'm just saying it's already been phased out again with the next generation of core network protocols.
What's in 5G? Maybe we can start with that already.
It's RESTful webs. No, RESTful web services specified in Open API over HTTP 2.0.
2.0?
Yes.
What?
Yes. And if you look at it, it's doing exactly what Diameter did before, and Diameter does exactly what Map did before. So there's no technical reason whatsoever other than you have to reinvent the wheel all over again and pay, you know, thousands of developers to do something and you have new patterns or whatnot. But there's no technical reason whatsoever. Well, in any case, I'm just saying. Yeah. Any other questions, comments?
So, regarding this translator, do you see it as a separate application? And you said that you plan to use Erlang implementation of Diameter. So, for GSAP, do you plan to implement it in Erlang or yeah?
Yeah, I mean, it's not so much, it's not so complex.
Actually, we have implementation of GSAP in Erlang, but I will discuss, maybe we can just open source this part so it can be reused because...
Yeah, that would be great. Would be great.
We'll discuss with Alex.
Yeah.
Because the Diameter is implemented in Erlang, so it will be really simple to...
Yeah, that would be useful and definitely help that along because it's even it's just the encoding decoding part, right? I mean, all the logic can be outside, but just the encoding decoding functions. More questions, comments, or do we close that? Who here has played with LTE in this room? So far? Okay. At least half or so. Well, okay. Yeah. Should have raised my hand, but yeah. Okay. Then thanks and